The Burial of the Guns by Thomas Nelson Page. Chapter 2, Part 1. The Burial of the Guns. Lee surrendered the remnant of his army at Appomattox, April 9, 1865, and yet a couple of days later the old colonel's battery lay entrenched right in the mountain pass where it had halted 3 days before. 2 weeks previously it had been detailed with a light division sent to meet and repel a force which it was understood was coming in by way of the Southwest Valley to strike Lee in the rear of his long line from Richmond to Petersburg. It had done its work. The mountain pass had been seized and held, and the Federal force had not gotten by that road within the blue rampart which guarded on that side the heart of Virginia. This pass, which was the key to the main line of passage over the mountains, had been assigned by the commander of the division to the old colonel and his old battery, and they had held it. The position taken by the battery had been chosen with a soldier's eye. A better place could not have been selected to hold the pass. It was its highest point, just where the road crawled over the shoulder of the mountain along the limestone cliff, 100 feet sheer above the deep river, where its waters had cut their way in ages past, and now lay deep and silent, as if resting after their arduous toil before they began to boil over the great boulders which filled the bed 100 or more yards below. The little plateau at the top guarded the descending road on either side for nearly a mile, and the mountain on the other side of the river was the center of a clump of rocky, heavily timbered spurs, so inaccessible that no feet but those of wild animals or of the hardiest hunter had ever climbed it. On the side of the river on which the road lay, the only path out over the mountain except the road itself was a charcoal burner's track, dwindling at times to a footway known only to the mountain folk, which a picket at the top could hold against an army. The position, well defended, was impregnable, and it was well defended. This the general of the division knew when he detailed the old colonel and gave him his order to hold the pass until relieved, and not let his guns fall into the hands of the enemy. He knew both the colonel and his battery. The battery was one of the oldest in the army. It had been in the service since April 1861, and its commander had come to be known as the wheel horse of his division. He was, perhaps, the oldest officer of his rank in his branch of the service. Although he had bitterly opposed secession, and was many years past the age of service when the war came on, yet as soon as the President called on the state for her quota of troops to coerce South Carolina, he had raised and uniformed an artillery company, and offered it, not to the President of the United States, but to the Governor of Virginia. It is just at this point that he suddenly looms up to me as a soldier, the relation he never wholly lost to me afterward, though I knew him for many, many years of peace. His gray coat with the red facing and the bars on the collar, his military cap, his gray flannel shirt. It was the first time I ever saw him wear anything but immaculate linen. His high boots, his horse caparisoned with a black high-peaked saddle, with crupper and breast-girth, instead of the light English hunting saddle to which I had been accustomed, all come before me now as if it were but the other day. I remember but little beyond it, yet I remember, as if it were yesterday, his leaving home and the scenes which immediately preceded it, the excitement created by the news of the President's call for troops, the unanimous judgment that it meant war, the immediate determination of the old colonel, who had hitherto opposed secession, that it must be met, the suppressed agitation on the plantation, attendant upon the tender of his services and the governor's acceptance of them, the prompt and continuous work incident to the enlistment of the men, the bustle of preparation, and all the scenes of that time come before me now. It turned the calm current of the life of an old and placid country neighborhood, far from any city or center, and stirred it into a boiling torrent, strong enough or fierce enough to cut its way and join the general torrent which was bearing down and sweeping everything before it. It seemed but a minute before the quiet old plantation, in which the harvest, the corn shucking, and the Christmas holidays alone marked the passage of the quiet seasons, and where a strange carriage or a single horseman coming down the big road was an event in life, was turned into a depot of war supplies, and the neighborhood became a parade ground. The old colonel, not a colonel yet, nor even a captain, except by brevet, was on his horse by daybreak, and off on his rounds through the plantations and the pines, enlisting his company. The office in the yard, heretofore one in name only, became one now in reality, and a table was set out, piled with papers, pens, ink, books of tactics and regulation, at which men were accepted and enrolled. Soldiers seemed to spring from the ground, as they did from the sowing of the dragon's teeth in the days of Cadmus. Men came up the high road or down the paths across the fields, sometimes singly, but oftener in little parties of two or three, and, asking for the captain, entered the office as private citizens and came out soldiers enlisted for the war. There was nothing heard of us on the plantation except fighting. White and black, all were at work, and all were eager. The servants contended for the honor of going with their master. The women flocked to the house to assist in the work of preparation, cutting out and making underclothes, knitting socks, picking lint, preparing bandages, and sewing on uniforms, for many of the men who had enlisted were of the poorest class, far too poor to furnish anything themselves, and their equipment had to be contributed mainly by wealthier neighbors. The work was carried on at night as well as by day, for the occasion was urgent. Meantime, the men were being drilled by the captain and his lieutenants, who had been militia officers of old. We were carried to see the drill at the crossroads, and a brave sight it seemed to us, the lines marching and countermarching in the field, with the horses galloping as they wheeled amid clouds of dust at the hoarse commands of the excited officers, and the roadside lined with spectators of every age and condition. I recall the arrival of the messenger one night, with a telegraphic order to the captain to report with his company at Camp Lee immediately. The hush in the parlor that attended its reading, then the forced beginning of the conversation afterwards in a somewhat strained and unnatural key, and the captain's quick and decisive outlining of his plans. Within the hour, a dozen messengers were on their way in various directions to notify the members of the command of the summons, and to deliver the order for their attendance at a given point next day. It seemed that a sudden and great change had come. It was the actual appearance of what had hitherto only been theoretical, war. The next morning the captain, in full uniform, took leave of the assembled plantation, with a few solemn words commending all he left behind to God, and galloped away up the big road to join and lead his battery to the war, and to be gone just 4 years. Within a month he was on the peninsula with Magruder, guarding Virginia on the east against the first attack. His camp was first at Yorktown, and then on Jamestown Island, the honor having been assigned his battery of guarding the oldest cradle of the race on this continent. It was at Little Bethel that his guns were first trained on the enemy, and that the battery first saw what they had to do, and from this time until the middle of April, 1865, they were in service, and no battery saw more service or suffered more in it. Its story was a part of the story of the Southern Army in Virginia. The captain was a rigid disciplinarian, and his company had more work to do than most new companies. A pious churchman, of the old puritanical type not uncommon to Virginia, he looked after the spiritual as well as the physical welfare of his men, and his chaplain or he read prayers at the head of his company every morning during the war. At first he was not popular with the men. He made the duties of camp life so onerous to them. It was nothing but drilling and praying all the time, they said. but he had not commanded very long before they came to know the stuff that was in him. He had not been in service a year before he had had 4 horses shot under him, and when later on he was offered the command of a battalion, the old company petitioned to be one of his batteries, and still remained under his command. Before the first year was out, the battery had, through its own elements and the discipline of the captain, become a cohesive force and a distinct integer in the Army of Northern Virginia. Young farmer recruits knew of its prestige and expressed preference for it of many batteries of rapidly growing or grown reputation. Owing to its high stand, the old and clumsy guns with which it had started out were taken from it, and in their place was presented a battery of 4 fine, brass, 12-pound Napoleons of the newest and most approved kind, and 2 3-inch Parrots, all captured. The men were as pleased with them as children with new toys. The care and attention needed to keep them in prime order broke the monotony of camp life. They soon had abundant opportunities to test their power. They worked admirably, carried far, and were extraordinarily accurate in their aim. The men, from admiration of their guns, grew to have first a pride in, and then an affection for them, and gave them nicknames as they did their comrades, the 4 Napoleons being dubbed the Evangelists, and the 2 rifles being the Eagle, because of its scream and force, and the Cat, because when it became hot from rapid firing, it jumped, they said, like a cat. From many a hilltop in Virginia, Maryland, and Pennsylvania, the Evangelists spoke their hoarse message of battle and death. The Eagle screamed her terrible note, and the Cat jumped as she spat her deadly shot from her hot throat. In the Valley of Virginia, on the levels of Henrico and Hanover, on the slopes of Manassas, in the woods of Chancellorsville, on the heights of Fredericksburg, at Antietam and Gettysburg, in the Spotsylvania wilderness, and again on the Hanover levels and on the lines before Petersburg, the old guns through nearly 4 years roared from fiery throats their deadly messages. The history of the battery was bound up with the history of Lee's army. A rivalry sprang up among the detachments of the different guns, and their several records were jealously kept. The number of duels each gun was in was carefully counted, every scar got in battle was treasured, and the men around their campfires, at their scanty messes, or on the march, bragged of them among themselves and avouched them as witnesses. New recruits coming in to fill the gaps made by the killed and disabled readily fell in with the common mood and caught the spirit like a contagion. It was not an uncommon thing for a wheel to be smashed in by a shell, but if it happened to one gun oftener than to another, there was envy. 2 of the Evangelists seemed to be especially favored in this line, while the Cat was so exempt as to become the subject of some derision. The men stood by the guns till they were knocked to pieces, and when the fortune of the day went against them, had with their own hands, oftener than once, save them after most of their horses were killed. This had happened in turn to every gun, the men at times working like beavers in mud up to their thighs and under a murderous fire to get their guns out. Many a man had been killed tugging at trail or wheel when the day was against them, but not a gun had ever been lost. At last the evil day arrived. At Winchester, a sudden and impetuous charge for a while swept everything before it, and carried the knoll where the old battery was posted. But all the guns were got out by the toiling and rapidly dropping men, except the Cat, which was captured with its entire detachment working at it until they were surrounded and knocked from the piece by cavalrymen. Most of the men who were not killed were retaken before the day was over, with many guns, but the Cat was lost. She remained in the enemy's hands and probably was being turned against her old comrades and lovers. The company was inconsolable. The death of comrades was too natural and common a thing to depress the men beyond what such occurrences necessarily did. But to lose a gun, it was like losing the old colonel. It was worse. A gun was ranked as a brigadier, and the cat was equal to a major general. The other guns seemed lost without her. The eagle especially, which generally went next to her, appeared to the men to have a lonely and subdued air. The battery was no longer the same. It seemed broken and depleted, shrunken to a mere section. It was worse than Cold Harbor, where over half the men were killed or wounded. The old captain, now colonel of the battalion, appreciated the loss and apprehended its effect on the men as much as they themselves did, and the application was made for a gun to take the place of the lost piece. But there was none to be had, as the men said they had known all along. It was added, perhaps by a department clerk, that if they wanted a gun to take the place of the one they had lost, they had better capture it. "By God, we will," they said, adding epithets intended for the department clerk in his bomb-proof, not to be printed in this record. And they did. For some time afterwards, in every engagement into which they got, there used to be speculation among them as to whether the cat were not there on the other side, some of the men swearing they could tell her report, and even going to the rash length of offering bets on her presence. By one of those curious coincidences, as strange as anything in fiction, a new general had, in 1864, come down across the Rapidan to take Richmond, and the old battery had found a hilltop in the line in which Lee's army lay stretched across the wilderness country to stop him. The day, though early in May, was a hot one, and the old battery, like most others, had suffered fearfully. Two of the guns had had wheels cut down by shells, and the men had been badly cut up. But the fortune of the day had been with Lee, and a little before nightfall, after a terrible fight, there was a rapid advance, Lee's infantry sweeping everything before it, and the artillery, after opening the way for the charge, pushing along with it, now unlimbering as some vantage ground was gained, and using canister with deadly effect, now driving ahead again so rapidly that it was mixed up with the muskets when the long line of breastworks was carried with a rush, and a line of guns were caught still hot from their rapid work. As the old battery, with lathered horses and smoke-grimed men, swung up the crest and unlimbered on the captured breastwork, a cheer went up which was heard even above the long general yell of the advancing line, and for a moment half the men in the battery crowded together around some object on the edge of the redoubt, yelling like madmen. The next instant they divided, and there was the cat, smoke-grimed and blood-stained and still sweating hot from her last fire, being dragged from her muddy ditch by as many men as could get hold of trail rope or wheel, and rushed into her old place beside the eagle, in time to be double-shotted with canister to the muzzle, and to pour it from among her old comrades into her now retiring former masters. Still, she had a new carriage, and her record was lost, while those of the other guns had been faithfully kept by the men. This made a difference in her position, for which even the bullets in her wheels did not wholly atone. Even Harris, the sergeant of her detachment, felt that. It was only a few days later, however, that abundant atonement was made. The new general did not retire across the Rapidan after his first defeat, and a new battle had to be fought, a battle, if anything, more furious, more terrible than the first, when the dead filled the trenches and covered the fields. He simply marched by the left flank, and Lee, marching by the right flank to head him, flung himself upon him again at Spotsylvania Courthouse. That day the cat, standing in her place behind the new and temporary breastwork thrown up when the battery was posted, had the fellows of her wheels, which showed above the top of the bank, entirely cut away by many bullets, so that when she jumped in the recoil, her wheels smashed and let her down. This covered all old scores. The other guns had been cut down by shells or solid shot, but never before had one been gnawed down by musket balls. From this time all through the campaign, the cat held her own beside her brazen and bloody sisters, and in the cold trenches before Petersburg that winter, when the new general, Starvation, had joined the one already there, she made her bloody mark as often as any gun on the long lines. Thus the old battery had come to be known, as its old commander, now colonel of a battalion, had come to be known by those in yet higher command. And when in the opening spring of 1865 it became apparent to the leaders of both armies that the long line could not longer be held if a force should enter behind it, and, sweeping the one partially unswept portion of Virginia, cut the railways in the southwest, and a man was wanted to command the artillery in the expedition sent to meet this force, it was not remarkable that the old colonel and his battalion should be selected for the work. The force sent out was but small, for the long line was worn to a thin one in those days, and great changes were taking place, the consequences of which were known only to the commanders. In a few days the commander of the expedition found that he must divide his small force for a time, at least, to accomplish his purpose, and sending the old colonel with one battery of artillery to guard one pass, must push on over the mountain by another way to meet the expected force, if possible, and repel it before it crossed the farther range. Thus the old battery, on an April evening of 1865, found itself toiling alone up the steep mountain road which leads above the river to the Gap, which formed the chief pass in that part of the Blue Ridge. Both men and horses looked, in the dim and waning light of the gray April day, rather like shadows of the beings they represented than the actual beings themselves. And anyone seeing them as they toiled painfully up, the thin horses floundering in the mud, and the men, often up to their knees, tugging at the sinking wheels, now stopping to rest and always moving so slowly that they seemed scarcely to advance at all, might have thought them the ghosts of some old battery lost from some long-gone and forgotten war on that deep and desolate mountain road. Often, when they stopped, the blowing of the horses and the murmuring of the river in its bed below were the only sounds heard, and the tired voices of the men, when they spoke among themselves, seemed hardly more articulate sounds than they. Then the voice of the mounted figure on the roan horse, half hidden in the mist, would cut in, clear and inspiring, in a tone of encouragement more than of command, and everything would wake up. The drivers would shout and crack their whips. The horses would bend themselves on the collars and flounder in the mud. The men would spring once more to the mud-clogged wheels, and the slow ascent would begin again. The orders to the colonel, as has been said, were brief: to hold the pass until he received further instructions, and not to lose his guns. To be ordered with him was to obey. The last streak of twilight brought them to the top of the pass. His soldier's instinct and a brief recognizance made earlier in the day told him that this was his place, and before daybreak next morning the point was as well fortified as a night's work by weary and supperless men could make it. A prettier spot could not have been found for the purpose. A small plateau, something over an acre in extent, where a charcoal burner's hut had once stood, lay right at the top of the pass. It was a little higher on either side than in the middle, where a small brook, along which the charcoal burner's track was yet visible, came down from the wooded mountain above, thus giving a natural crest to aid the fortification on either side, with open space for the guns, while the edge of the wood coming down from the mountain afforded shelter for the camp. As the battery was unsupported, it had to rely on itself for everything, a condition which most soldiers by this time were accustomed to. A dozen or so of rifles were in the camp, and with these pickets were armed and posted. The pass had been seized none too soon. A scout brought in the information before nightfall that the invading force had crossed the farther range before that sent to meet it could get there, and taking the nearest road had avoided the main body opposing it, and been met only by a rapidly moving detachment, nothing more than a scouting party, and now were advancing rapidly on the road on which they were posted, evidently meaning to seize the pass and cross the mountain at this point. The day was Sunday, a beautiful spring Sunday, but it was no Sabbath for the old battery. All day the men worked, making and strengthening their redoubt to guard the pass, and by the next morning, with the old battery at the top, it was impregnable. They were just in time. Before noon their vedettes brought in word that the enemy were ascending the mountain, and the sun had hardly turned when the advance guard rode up, came within range of the picket, and were fired on. It was apparent that they supposed the force there only a small one, for they retired and soon came up again, reinforced in some numbers, and a sharp little skirmish ensued, hot enough to make them more prudent afterwards, though the picket retired up the mountain. This gave them encouragement and probably misled them, for they now advanced boldly. They saw the redoubt on the crest as they came on, and, unlimbering a section or two, flung a few shells up at it, which either fell short or passed over without doing material damage. None of the guns was allowed to respond, as the distance was too great with the ammunition the battery had, and, indifferent as it was too precious to be wasted in a duel at an ineffectual range. Doubtless deceived by this, the enemy came on in force, being obliged by the character of the ground to keep almost entirely to the road, which really made them advance in column. The battery waited. Under orders of the colonel, the guns standing in line were double-shotted with canister, and, loaded to the muzzle, were trained down to sweep the road at from 400 to 500 yards distance. And when the column reached this point, the six guns, aimed by old and skillful gunners, at a given word swept road and mountainside with a storm of leaden hail. It was a fire no mortal man could stand up against, and the practiced gunners rammed their pieces full again, and before the smoke had cleared or the reverberation had died away among the mountains, had fired the guns again and yet again. The road was cleared of living things when the draft setting down the river drew the smoke away. But it was no discredit to the other force, for no army that was ever uniformed could stand against that battery in that pass. Again and again the attempt was made to get a body of men up under cover of the woods and rocks on the mountainside, while the guns below utilized their better ammunition from longer range. But it was useless. Although one of the lieutenants and several men were killed in the skirmish, and a number more were wounded, though not severely, the old battery commanded the mountainside, and its skillful gunners swept it at every point the foot of man could scale. The sun went down, flinging his last flame on a victorious battery still crowning the mountain pass. The dead were buried by night in a corner of the little plateau, borne to their last bivouac on the old gun carriages which they had stood by so often, which the men said would sort of ease their minds. The next day the fight was renewed, and with the same result. The old battery in its position was unconquerable. Only one fear now faced them. Their ammunition was getting as low as their rations. Another such day or half-day would exhaust it. A sergeant was sent back down the mountain to try to get more, or, if not, to get tidings. The next day it was supposed the fight would be renewed, and the men waited, alert, eager, vigilant, their spirits high, their appetite for victory whetted by success. The men were at their breakfast, or what went for breakfast, scanty at all times, now doubly so, hardly deserving the title of a meal, so poor and small were the portions of cornmeal, cooked in their frying pans, which went for their rations, when the sound of artillery below broke on the quiet air. They were on their feet in an instant and at the guns, crowding upon the breastwork to look or to listen, for the road, as far as could be seen down the mountain, was empty except for their own picket, and lay as quiet as if sleeping in the balmy air. And yet volley after volley of artillery came rolling up the mountain. What could it mean? That the rest of their force had come up and was engaged with that at the foot of the mountain? the colonel decided to be ready to go and help them, to fall on the enemy in the rear. Perhaps they might capture the entire force. It seemed the natural thing to do, and the guns were limbered up in an incredibly short time, and a roadway made through the entrenchment, the men working like beavers under the excitement. Before they had left the redoubt, however, the vedettes sent out returned and reported that there was no engagement going on, and the firing below seemed to be only practicing. There was quite a stir in the camp below, but they had not even broken camp. This was mysterious. Perhaps it meant that they had received reinforcements, but it was a queer way of showing it. The old colonel sighed as he thought of the good ammunition they could throw away down there, and of his empty limber chests. It was necessary to be on the alert, however. The guns were run back into their old places, and the horses picketed once more back among the trees. Meantime, he sent another messenger back, this time a courier, for he had but one commissioned officer left, and the picket below was strengthened. End of chapter 2, part 1.